Yeah, I'm going to ask real quick. Matt, can you go get me, thank you, can you go get me a cup of water? This is one of the styrofoam cups. I'm having a chance of having a break here to get a drink. Still battling with what everybody else seems to be battling with, the RSV, the respiratory stuff, but God is gracious. All right, we are actually going to step away from our study in the book of Galatians. We've been going at it for four really hard weeks, and we've been into some deep things concerning our salvation and the defense of our salvation. And as I was kind of looking at the lessons that are coming up, they really set up very nicely for communion that we're going to be having on March 12th. And so this week, possibly next week, we might be doing something a little bit different, and then we'll be back into the book of Galatians. Let me read some verses for you. These are very familiar verses to us here. I'll wait until my drink here. That is just water, correct?
Yeah, holy water.
If it was Diet Mountain Dew, I could do better. Thank you very much. And these are verses, and actually over the last probably 5-6 months, we've referred to these verses a number of times, but I want to put them all together for us for just a moment here. It says in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10 through 12, it says, "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the full armor of God so that you will be able to stand firm against the schemes of the devil. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers, against the world forces of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in heavenly places." 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 55, it says this, "O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." And then 2 Corinthians chapter 10, it says, "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but divinely powerful for the destruction of fortresses. We are destroying speculation and every lofty thing that raised up against the knowledge of God. And we are taking every thought captive to the obedience of Christ." And then finally, 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 20. Let's read this verse together. We're going to read it twice, all right? "For the kingdom of God does not consist in words, but in power." Let's read that again together. "For the kingdom of God does not consist in words, but in power." I mean, no one can deny that one of the greatest illustrations of our faith in Jesus Christ, is that of a military battle. What it means to be a Christian. I mean, did you catch all of those descriptive phrases that I read in those 3 or 4 verses there? It talks about putting on the armor of God. Take your stand. Death being swallowed up in victory. It tells us to wage war, to demolish strongholds, to take captives. I mean, what a great picture. Now let me ask you, does that sound like a description of what your day-to-day relationship with the Lord is like? Does that sound like what your Christian faith is, your walk? You know, putting on God's armor, standing, you know, waging war, demolishing strongholds in your life. I mean, with Christ in your life, do you feel like you're going through the day and the enemy is pressing out, but you're standing firm, you know, victorious, putting back any of the advancements, taking new territory for Christ? Does that describe what your week looks like? Not your Sunday morning. But does that describe your walk with Christ throughout the week? Let me rephrase the question for you. Does what we have read even sound like something you expect from your faith? Do you expect your faith to help you stand in the Lord? To help you be different? Do you expect your faith, and you want it to be engaged to help you so that you're not tossed to and fro by the enemy and the schemes of the devil? I mean, do you even expect Christ to have an impact upon how you deal with your day-to-day life? Well, I come to church on Sunday, and, you know, we learn about it, and we study about it, and it's all great, I'll agree with it, but then the rest rest of the week, it really doesn't have any reflection to what happens on Sunday morning. I mean, Ephesians chapter 6:10 says, be strong in the Lord in his mighty power. 2 Corinthians 10 says, our weapons have divine power to demolish strongholds. We'll put up 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 20 again. It says, for the kingdom of God does not consist in words, but in power. So again, is your faith giving you divine ability? Does it make any difference in your life that you say that you are a Christian? Does it make any difference throughout the week? Do you even expect it to have an impact on your day-to-day life and the decisions that you make? I mean, the kingdom of God that if we're Christians, we're a part of, it does not consist in words. Not just about all talking about it. But it's power that we have been given by God through the Holy Spirit. And that's what I want to talk about this morning. And using a military setting as a backdrop, I want us to go, we're going to go to the book of 2 Samuel chapter 8. Excuse me, if you haven't turned there already. We're going to take a look at David. We're actually coming towards the end of David's military conquest in his life. We're probably about midway through his reign when we step into chapter 8 here. And we're going to see a man of God living. What does it mean to live by the power of God? So let me read, and I'm going to have you stand if you would. I'd like to read 2 Samuel chapter 8, verses 1 through 14. And it says, now after this, it came about that David defeated the Philistines, and he subdued them. And David took control of the chief cities from the hand of the Philistines. He defeated Moab, and he measured them with a lion, making them lie down on the ground. And he measured two lions to put to death, and one full lion to keep alive. And the Moabites became servants to David, bringing tribute. Then David defeated Hadazar, the son of Rahab, king of Zobah, and he went to restore his rule at the river. David captured from him 1,700 horsemen and 20,000 foot soldiers. And David hamstrung the chariot horses, but he reserved enough of them for 100 chariots. When the Arameans of Damascus came to help Hadazar, king of Zobah, David killed 22,000 Arameans. Then David put garrisons among the Arameans of Damascus, and the Arameans became servants to David, bringing tribute to him. And the Lord helped David wherever he went. David took the shields of gold which were carried by the servants and Hadazar, and he brought them to Jerusalem from Betha, from Berathai, cities of Hadazar. King David took a very large amount of bronze. Now when Tou, king of Hamath, heard that David had defeated all the army of Hadazar, Tou sent Joram, his son, to King David to greet him and to bless him because he had fought against Hadazar and defeated him. For Hadazar had been at war with Tou, and Joram brought with him articles of silver and of gold and of bronze. King David also dedicated these to the Lord with the silver and gold which he had dedicated from all the nations which he had subdued. From Aram and Moab and the sons of Ammon and the Philistines and Amalek and from the spoils of Hadazar, son of Rahab, king of Zobah. So David made a name for himself when he returned from killing 18,000 Arameans in the Valley of Salt. He put garrisons in Edom. In all of Edom he put garrisons. And all of Edom became servants to David. And the Lord helped David wherever he went. You may be seated. And we need to remember that David's kingship in the physical realm is often used in the Bible to teach us something spiritually, something physically in the lives of his children. So in this reign of David, he's trying to teach you and I who know Christ as our Savior. He's trying to teach us something. Well, 2 Samuel 8 is more than just a simple list of David's conquests and the kings and the lands that he took. But 2 Samuel chapter 8 is a testimony to the completeness of David's rules on all fronts. In verse 1, he said he took care of the Philistines that lived in the western area up by the Mediterranean Sea. Verse 2, he took care of the Moabites. They were inhabited on the east side of the Dead Sea. In verse 6, the Syrians, there were two companies of them, north and northeast. In verse 14, the Edomites, they were the south and east of the Dead Sea. So literally, this portion could read, David ruled to the north and the south and the east and the west. And folks, I want to tell you, it would have been a lot easier to read if it just would have said that. You know, that David ruled from the east and south and north. Because all of those names. But this is important. Because under David's rule, and captain, this is going to be the first time that Israel has possessed all the land that the Lord had given them. This is going to be the first time that all of the promised land, the promise to Moses, the promise to Joshua and their generation, finally, all the land was going to be conquered. Now, if you remember, Israel had been given a promise way back in Joshua chapter 1, verse 17. It says, now it came about after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, that the Lord spoke to Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' servant, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore, arise, cross this Jordan, you and all your people, to the land which I am giving to them, to the sons of Israel. And get this, every place on which the sole of your foot treads, I have given it to you, just as I spoke to Moses. From the wilderness and this Lebanon, even as far as the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, and as far as the great sea towards the setting of the sun will be your territory. No man will be able to stand before you all the days of your life. Just as I have been with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not fail you or forsake you. Be strong and courageous, for you shall give this people possession of the land which I swore to their fathers to give them. Only be strong and very courageous. Be careful to do according to the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn to the right or to the left so that you might be successful wherever it is that you go. So Israel is given this great promise. Everywhere you set your foot, everywhere you go, that's mine, that's yours, that's yours. As far as the setting of the sun that you can see, He drew out the borders by the Mediterranean Sea and the Great Sea and the Salt Sea. He drew out the borders for Israel. And it says, no one is going to be able to stand against you. You just need to obey me. You need to follow me. You need to listen to me. But we all know the history of Israel. We know what happened when they got into the land. Israel settled. They settled for incomplete obedience. They claimed a partial victory. They claimed enough of the land to the point that they were comfortable. And then they began to settle. And again, the spiritual implications for our life, you can certainly see the bearing that this has on a Christian. I mean, we have these promises that have been given to us by God. You know, I'm talking about power, divine power, mighty power to live, you know, to demolish strongholds, to take captivities captive, you know, to live a victorious Christian life. We have a life with so many fronts to conquer for Jesus Christ. But too often we experience a level of mediocrity in our faith. We go off throughout the day, we go off throughout our week with multiple choices. Remember, God said to Joshua, just, you need to obey me, you need to follow me, and I'm going to give you victory. And he says the same thing to us, but we come, you know, throughout our day, we have choices all the time. We go this way or this way, and, you know, and we'll choose God's way. And then we come to another choice, this way, well, this time we choose the world's way. And we seem to vacillate from the world to God, choosing, you know, picking and choosing the places of victory that we're going to have in our life. But again, the Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians 4:20, the kingdom of God doesn't exist in words, but it exists in power. It's not about just the words that have been said, but there's power there. I mean, what if David had only talked? What if David got Israel together every Sunday morning, and they sang a few songs, and David, you know, for a half hour or so, he talked about, hey, we're God's people, and God has given us this land. And week after week after week. Do you think the enemy would just simply roll over? Boy, they're talking about it a lot. We better get out of here. Christian? How do we live in the mighty power? You know, how do we demolish the strongholds of our life and take captivities captive? Okay, number one, I'm going to talk about four things I've noticed here. Number one, David claimed what was his. All of it. He claimed what was his. God had promised to give this to the people of Israel. David claimed it. He didn't claim part of it. He didn't claim partial victory. He claimed total victory. And you cannot become content when the enemy still controls pockets in the land. And that's what Israel had done up to the time of David. They had been content with having some victory and defeats. I mean, we know about the book of Judges. It follows Joshua, and after the conquest of the land was subdued, but there were still pockets of the enemy all over. Well, chapter 1 of the book of Judges gives us a broad stroke account of Israel entering the land of Canaan and taking possession. We're not going to read it all here, but it describes the 12 tribes fighting victory. But as soon as they had enough land, they became comfortable. They did went to battle as a group, and then when they divided up and they split up, they just settled. They didn't completely take control of all the land that God had given them. The result of that is in Judges chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. Let me read these for you. It says, "Now the angel of the Lord came up from Gilgal to Bochan, and he said, I brought you up out of Egypt. I led you into the land which I have sworn to your fathers. And I said, I will never break my covenant with you. And as for you, you shall make no covenant with the inhabitants of this land. You shall tear down their altars. But you have not obeyed me. What is this you have done? Therefore I also said, I will not drive them out before you. But they will become as thorns in your sides, and their gods will become a snare to you." And from that point on, of them entering into the land, until you get to David, there were always pockets of the enemy that would constantly flare up and frustrate, often subject Israel to captivity. It'd be the Ammonites, then the Philistines, then the Amalekites. These are people that were supposed to have been driven out. These are territories that were supposed to be claimed for God. But Israel settled. They settled for comfort. You know, one thing you know, Israel never left the land. They never left the territory, but a lot of their time, there was no joy in living in God's promised land because of the enemy constantly needling them, the enemy constantly oppressing them. Whereas there's some spiritual lessons for us. I mean, when we come to know Christ as our Lord and Savior, when we are sealed by the Holy Spirit, and we have our ups and downs, and we found that when we're really down, we're obedient to God. Well, God doesn't cast us off. He doesn't say, you're not saved, you're not a child of mine anymore. But boy, that joy of our salvation. You know, how many of us are living in the joy of our salvation? How can we live like that when we have these enemies that we've not conquered? We've not given over to the Lord. But I want you to pay real close attention to this next point I'm going to make here. This is still under point one. But one thing I noticed here, most of Israelites' battles with the enemies, from the time that they went into the land until David, they came in reaction to the enemy. I mean, if we took time to read through the book of Judges, you see that, you know, the enemy would stir up. The Philistines were on the move. And as soon as the Philistines moved, then the Israelites would move. And then the Amalekites would take control. And then the Israelites would beat them back. Again, does this sound a lot like your Christian life a lot of the time? I mean, we're basically settled in, you know, to our faith. Christ is our Savior. You're His. He's yours. You know, I mean, He's helping me to make me a better person. But suddenly the enemy of anger flares up in your life. And then inflicts some casualties. And so you've got to beat it back. Oh, the walls of morality are crumbling. And so now you got to pay attention over here and shore those walls up. You shift your attention now to the tongue of gossip or of apathy or jealousy or integrity or unforgiveness. And you beat them back. so much like that during the time of Judges. We wait for the enemy to act, and then we react. And this is what I noticed about David. You know, again, we just have a capsulization about these victories. They're expanded a lot more in the verses that preceded. I noticed that David didn't wait for the enemy to attack and then muster his forces. He knew where the enemy was. He knew what the enemy was. And he knew that any enemy left would eventually cause a problem. And so, you know, it says in verse 3, David went and defeated Hadazar, the son of Rahab, the king of Zobah. And he went and restored his rule at the river. David pursued. David initiated. It says the same thing in verse 6. Then David put garrisons among the Arameans of Damascus. And the Arameans became servants to David, bringing tribute. And the Lord helped David wherever he went. David went. David pursued. Verse 14, it says, the Lord gave David victory wherever he went. On and on. It keeps repeating that phrase. You see, David didn't wait for the enemy to attack. If you read an expanded version of these battles, he went out and he initiated the enemy. So let me ask you this. In your faith, have you ever done this? Have you ever done this in your Christian life? Have you ever engaged the enemy when it wasn't giving you any problems? You know, when the enemy is dormant, that's when you want to attack, not when they're at full strength coming at you. I mean, the idea is don't wait until it strikes. The enemy is going to come after you. You know it eventually is going to be there, so act first. There's a front of anger. That's something that you got to deal with. Or maybe gossip or unforgiveness or jealousy or any other sin. It's eventually going to flare up. Don't wait for it to flare up. Act. Pray now when it's calm. Memorize the appropriate scripture. Learn the verses to know, hey, I don't want to go there. I don't want to be defeated. I don't want to be attacked in this area. You know, formulate a game plan, you know, to go after it. I mean, that's what it meant in 2 Corinthians 10, verse 3 through 5. For though we walk in the flesh, we don't war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but divinely powerful for the destruction of fortresses. You know what a fortress is? A fortress is something that is set. A fortress doesn't move. But you go after a fortress. It is divinely powerful for the destruction of fortresses, going to it. We're destroying speculations. Every lofty thing that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. We're taking every thought captive to the obedience of Jesus Christ. This is being progressive. We know these sins are there. We know where our danger areas are. Have you ever thought about addressing them now with the verses and times of prayer and seeking the Lord? That's what David did. That's the visual. He engaged the enemy. He didn't wait for the enemy to attack. Second thing, we're going to move a little bit quicker here. Number two, your environment must become subject to your faith. And your faith should not become subject to your environment. I mean, subjection means control. When you're subject to someone, they put control and limits on you. And that was one of the difficulties of Israel before David. Because all of this enemy there controlled them. It put them in subjection. It hindered their enjoying the land. You know, but the enemy, it says, became subject to David's leadership. David's lordship. So again, if you are in a situation where your Christianity is being controlled, is being subjected by wrong, you've got two choices. Well, you've got three. One's bad, but you've got two good choices. You need to change it. You need to change that situation, or you need to get out of it. If you are in a situation that is subjecting your faith and hindering your faith, you need to change it or get out of it. If you're at a job that calls you to lie or to cheat, or you know, you have to have this sort of an attitude about you and you know taking people down. If you're that kind of job, you need to change that environment, or you need to get out. If you're in a relationship with someone, and maybe talking about singles here, if you're in a relationship where you have to bend your morals to keep it. That boy, you know, to keep that boyfriend or that girlfriend, you know, that I have to become physically involved with them, sexually involved with them. You either need to change the dynamics of that situation, you need to get out of it. Because whatever you subject yourself to, that's what controls you. If you're in a friendship, you know, where, you know, that friendship, being friends, that person gets you involved in actions and attitudes that we shouldn't. You need to either be changing that environment or you need to be changing what your situation is. Number three, another quick one. Complete victory hinges on obedience to God's word. Again, you know, we have to go to the expanded edition of these battles here. But man, you see David obedient to God over and over and over again. Matter of fact, verse 15, so David made a name for himself when he returned from killing 18,000 Arameans in the Saul's Bowl. Excuse me, that's verse 13. Verse 15, so David reigned over all of Israel, and David administered justice and righteousness for all the people. That was David's standard, justice and righteousness, complete obedience to the word of God. And number four, David ruled every single one of these fronts with an eye on God. That David said, I'm ruling for God. And all of these fronts were kept because of God. You know, it says in verse 11 there, King David also dedicated these to the Lord with the silver and the gold that he had dedicated from all the nations which he had subdued. These victories that David wrought, that God did through David, they weren't about David then taking all of the spoils and amounting gold and silver unto himself. Remember, what was David, the desire of David's heart was to build the temple. To build a place of worship that was more glorious than anything that the world had ever seen. Even that would fall short of the glory of God. But it would be a place that would reflect their relationship with God. And so, as David subdued these nations, defeated every nation, it was all with an eye on God. All that he took, he dedicated it to the Lord. He didn't keep any of it to himself. And you know, a lot of times, I'll disappoint myself, but boy, it's one thing, you know, to disappoint God. We rule these fronts because we have a Savior, Jesus Christ, who died for us, who gave his life for us. It's not about me. I might put up with this in my life. I might put up with that moral lapse or put up with this attitude. But Jesus Christ, when I'm doing it for him, then we have victories on all of our fronts. You know, so often we become content with second best. We become content with living with the pockets of enemy in our lives. But God never does. God never becomes content with that. I mean, David, this kingdom is God's. This is all of his. He has told us where these boundaries are, this land that he has given us. And David took all the land for God. And for us, we need to stand. We need to say, this life is God's life, bought and paid for by the blood of Jesus Christ. I do this for him. You know, it's not for me. I do this for him to honor and glorify him. 1 Corinthians 4:20. One last time, I'm going to put this up here for you. For the kingdom of God does not consist in words, but in power. Is yours a Christian life of power? Are you engaging your faith throughout the week? Do you even desire it? Do you desire for your Christian faith to lead you and guide you throughout your week, to give you victory? It's going to take time. But you need to, number one, you need to claim all that is yours in Christ. Don't ever settle. Don't leave pockets of the enemy of sin in your life. Secondly, you need to subject your environment to your faith. That everything is a reflection of your faith. Your job is a reflection of your faith. Your home, your entertainment, your service, your worship, everything. My interaction with my neighbors is to be a front. A reflection of my faith given to God. Number three, complete victory hinges on obedience to God's word. Complete obedience. Number four, we do this for God. We don't do this for ourselves. He needs to be the focus of our lives, what we're trying to live, to honor and glorify Him, to receive at the end, to receive that well done, good and faithful servant. Let's pray. Father, I want to start by first asking your forgiveness for the times that I've settled in my life, that I've allowed things that have no place with your holiness, to just accept them, to not do bad with them. Sometimes I didn't have enough faith, didn't have strength enough to do it. I was doing it in my own strength, whatever, Father. I just confess to it's wrong. Father, you use this spiritual battle in our lives to shape us and to mold us. And I'm sorry, Father, for the times that I've forgotten that. Lord, for everybody here who knows you, I'm just asking you right now, Lord, to even begin to bring to our mind those areas, those fronts that are there, Lord, that need to be captured in our life. Each one of us is going to be different. But God, I don't want to settle. I want to finish well until the day I stand before Jesus Christ. So move in our lives, Father. The Spirit that you've placed within us will bring these things to our mind. Throughout this week, Lord, let us engage our faith on the word of our friends. We'll thank you in thy Son's name. You would take your hymnals out, and we're going to turn to number 732, The Battle Belongs to the Lord. I'm going to invite you to stand together with us. And once again, if anyone ever wants to talk about that, I know we preach these messages, and we strike nerves, spiritual nerves. We're supposed to, the Holy Spirit is, but it's easy just to walk away from that, and then we go on. If you want to talk deeper, I would love to talk to you. I'd love to pray with you. And so just get a hold of me. Number 732, we'll sing that first verse. The battle belongs to the Lord. In heavenly armor we'll enter the land. The battle belongs to the Lord. The weapons that fashioned against us will stand. The battle belongs to the Lord. And we sing glory.
Love.